Gracias. Welcome to Global Hedonism. Last time we talked about tequila. Today I want to talk about the plant that gives us tequila, agave. And there's one other distillate which is made from agave, which is mezcal. Now, tequila is restricted to the region of tequila and on the northeast to Tampico. Mezcal cannot be grown everywhere, but there are 9 different states within Mexico which can produce mezcal and be recognized within the origin denomination. But let's get back to the plant, to the agave. Now, like I said, tequila has to be made with the blue agave or agave tequilana. But the mezcal denomination, while it includes a listing of several different agaves, there is not a specific restriction to a number of type of agaves, so you will find quite a variety of agaves being used in the production. And especially in mezcal, the particular agave is going to have a very strong influence on the final product. Now, before I start talking about the different agaves and which notes you can expect from the agaves or other things, I want to talk to you about yields. Now, when you think about the production of whiskey, you need barley to produce the malt. And barley takes 60 to 70 days to grow from planting to maturity. Now, grapes, you need to plant the vines and wait for 3 years to be able to collect some usable grapes. But then it will keep giving you grapes once a year for the next 50 years, maybe up to 70 years, depending on how long you keep it. Even though the yields will drop and you're of course subject to different climatic conditions each year. But for the tequila, for agave, you need the plant to reach full maturity. And this usually takes, for a shorter lived plant, 6 to 8 years for the agave tequilana, 8 to 10 years for an agave espadín, which is also one of the most common ones, and up to 20 or 30 years as an example for a Tempestate agave. So when you think about it, in 20, 30 years, you'll be harvesting 20, 30 years of barley, while you would only harvest once the agave. Because what happens is, agave blooms only once in its life. And while you recognize the normal leaves, once it reaches maturity, it creates a shootout. And this shootout is where the plant blooms and produces the seeds. To produce tequila or mezcal, they cut the shootout. So the chemical processes which lead to the blooming of the plant are still happening, but all the sugar that's being produced is not going to this shootout, but being concentrated in what we call the piña, the heart of the plant. After the plant dies, which is the normal process, it is uprooted and then cooked, crushed, then it goes to fermentation and finally distillation, and you get the tequila or the mezcal. But you see, you waited 10, 20 years to get one plant and the plant is gone now. Now, for sure, for the blue agave or for espadín, you can use the hijuelos, which is little agave plants that they produce close to the root, and just transplant them, and this is just like clones of the same plant. But in what is called the silvestre agaves, you have to one plant, let the shootout grow. You cannot use it, of course, for tequila or mezcal. And then it blooms and then you get some seeds and then you can plant these seeds to create the next batch. But then again, you have to wait maybe 10, maybe 20 years to get the seeds. As such, thinking about the yield, mezcal should be quite more expensive than any whiskey. Now, let's talk about the different agaves. We have the most common one is the agave espadín. It has very long, thin leaves, which look kind of like swords, which is why it's called espadín, since the word for sword in Spanish is espada. Then there's the tobalá, very characteristic in its small shape, has lower yields. Here's a short video of a row of tobalá agaves. There's also one of the most characteristic ones are the Karwinski family. Most known of them is the Madrigüisen, And the madrecuiche has a very distinct moist earth and banana aromas. You also have different agaves like the cupriata, also known as papalote or papalome, which has a very strong plantain note. So as you can see, there's a lot of variety in the different agaves, and due to the batch of mezcal is limited by the size of the oven in which you cook the piñas. And so sometimes you don't have enough piñas of one type to make a single one, but what they do is, and also gives richness to the mezcal, you take different piñas of different agaves and you bake them together, you crush them together, fermentation and distillation, of course, together, and then you get what's called an ensemble with different types of agave. And this adds different notes, so the acidity of an espadín or the particular plantain and moist earth aromas of a Karwinski or a cupriata. Now, there's going to be another couple of episodes talking about the process of mezcal, and the next one we're going to talk about distillation. So make sure to subscribe to get notified about it. Make sure to check out the description, there's our merch store, and I'll see you on the next one.